Hey friends, today on Kelly's Cars, we're going to be doing a water pump on my 2015 Challenger. Now, a couple weeks ago, I was out at work and I walk out to the parking lot, notice there is a puddle of coolant underneath it, which tells me one thing and one thing only, this water pump's about to go. And I've got about 175,000 miles on my 2015 Challenger, so it's just a matter of time. And right now in the free state of Arizona, it's January, so it's not super hot, so I could be a complete scumbag and let it kind of ride until it starts getting warmer out. I'm gonna have problems. Luckily, this water pump is fairly easy, fairly straightforward to replace. So let's go downstairs, let's grab some tools, and let's put this new water pump in the Challenger. Luckily, you don't need a lot of tools to do this. Right now, currently, I have a screwdriver, a pair of BFPs, I've got a 15 and a 16 mil, and also a drain pan. Downstairs, I have a 19 millimeter socket, a 19 millimeter wrench, a 13 millimeter socket, a 13 millimeter wrench, and of course, a 10 mil. And that's really all you're really going to need. And the great thing is, unlike some of the older garbage of the past, you don't need a gasket or gasket sealant because these things have this nice little rubber kind of O-ring gasket seal. So that makes things a lot easier. So the furry four-legged supervisor and I came out here this morning. And yes, I know, my Challenger's looking kind of sad, almost like a sideshow reject. Missing that front bumper cover, which it is upstairs, but let's look at something else important. Yeah, this thing is just barfing a lot of coolant out of it, so not really any possible way that I can make this thing ride until it starts getting warm out, so let's get that done. Okay, so first order of business is going to be draining the radiator, and one of the nice things about this thing not having a front bumper on it is you can clearly see that drain cock, and it's pretty easy to get to. Now, I'm a fake parts, break hearts type of guy, and usually I like to use factory stuff wherever possible, but when I did the radiator, this is in the middle of the pandemic, and honestly enough, the first thing that started leaking was a little bit of coolant weep around that petcock, and even replacing it didn't do anything for it, so new radiator happened. But while we're sitting right here, I'll throw you some part numbers. This is going to be your replacement part number for a Mopar brand water pump, and the nice thing about the Mopar brand pumps is you're going to come with a coolant temperature sensor as well, so you don't have to use a 19 millimeter to get that off. But if you need to, 19 millimeter deep well socket. The other thing too, while I'm at it, is I'm going to replace the thermostat as well. I might as well. Now, I went online and bought this water pump. I think I got it off of eBay. And going down to the dealership, they want $375 for water pump. Online, it was 160, 170. So yeah, I'll take 50% and wait a couple days. I actually did go down to the dealership yesterday to pick up the thermostat and I ended up paying $75. I mean, I remember the old days where it was $7 or $8 for a thermostat. Yeah, not going to happen. So as I said, we've got the full tool complement: flathead screwdriver, BFP, ratchet, 13 millimeter, and you've got a 16, 15, 13, and a 10. And of course, your multi-tool. So the other thing I did as well is I already took off the air intake hose here, this pipe. And for you 5.7 guys, I actually did the Hellcat Airbox mod. And I will tell you, the factory intake pipe here has like a little appendix off the side that quiets intake noise. This is off of Hellcat. I think Hellcat or maybe a Scat Pack. Either way, it doesn't have that little appendix and you hear all the intake noise. So a couple screwdrivers, bam, bam. Make sure you unplug your airflow meter. Let's get into it. Okay, friends, here's a don't be like me moment of the day. Make sure you write down, or at least draw or take a picture of the routing of your serpentine belt. And I will also mention, you can see where that tensioner is. There's that square hole right there. That's where you plug in your 3/8 ratchet. And I had mine set to tighten because you need to do clockwise to relieve the tension on the serpentine belt. There's not a lot of clearance, but we can see here, you've got an idler up here on the head. If I move my big old meat hook here, and you can see where it wraps down at the AC compressor. It's gonna go around the crank. It's gonna loop on the outside of the crank, and then it's gonna get the inside of that tensioner. Then it's gonna go directly across over here. Over to your alternator, wrap around back down. It's going to go underneath that tensioner and up on top. So this is where I highly stress to you, take a picture first. Don't be like me. So the old veteran here is my 13 millimeter black oxide snap-off open-end wrench.
you're going to take that pulley off with a 13 millimeter. Now, on some of the older cars, it's a different size. I think it's a 14, but for the 2015 and up Challengers, that's a 13 millimeter. That's going to be a 16 to pull that tensioner off. You're going to pull those off, disconnect your coolant sensor temperature deal, and then you're going to take a 10 mil to get this bypass pipe off. Let's play a game called How Much of an Idiot Am I? Make sure you are very, very, very careful when you remove this little plug. And I thought I was pushing on it, went to go pull it, and somehow the wires came out. So I got to go down to the dealership to get a new plug for this and crimp it back on. So don't do what I do, kids. Since I left my regular channel locks, water pump pliers, BFPs at my shop, and I didn't have them today, these things were giving me a fit. And I'm not sure what the special name or description for these pliers are, but they have like a variable leverage sort of deal on them. Weren't working so well. But from my days with the older Mopars, which have the spring style kind of hose clamps that are much like this, but they're circular, have a circular cross section, these pliers are made especially for those hose clamps. And because of the notches in the jaws are able to grab it, I was able to slip that hose clamp forward so that way I can get the lower radiator hose off. Okay, friends, here's our current situation. The water pump is actually ready to come out. So I'm just going to give you guys a quick little step-by-step here on what I actually did. So I pulled out the, don't mind the neighbor's pugs that are incessantly yapping, I pulled out the thermostat housing, which was two 13 millimeter bolts. Now I put all these bolts in their respective places they go, just because you have some that are different lengths, and this helps me keep track of them. And also, this is why I highly suggest to replace your thermostat, because I had to fight this a little bit and kind of got a little bent when I pulled the thermostat out, which I knew it would, but this part wasn't even connected to the thermostat, it was just sitting in there. So I need to replace it, obviously, and I did. And like I say, thankfully the car wasn't running hot at all, so I'm grateful for that. Now, I could be a complete hack like I did with that sensor and just use a ratcheting wrench, but I actually went back upstairs, got this Mac Tools nice little rubber hammer, so I'm going to just knock the water pump off of that. Now, I'm not going to go into detail with this clip. Just keep in mind, this is a good, great reason why to take your time. Don't do hackery like I did. In fact, I'll give you guys a quick little life hack here. Is take your 19 millimeter and you can rotate that sending unit to where you can actually see it. And I was pushing on the wrong spot down here and ended up just pulling those wires completely out of the crimping. So I'm just going to take a scribe or a pick and pop those connectors out and open them back up and just recrimp them on, put the whole thing back together. Save me a trip down to the dealership. So let me pull this water pump off. I'll get back to you guys in a second, and those dogs won't stop barking. Sorry. Yogi, what do you think about that? He doesn't even care. A few good whacks, and the water pump came out. Now, what I did here as well is I decided to take off the hose with the water pump, just that way I can access this, because it was kind of in a wacky spot. And you can see right there where that coolant weepage was coming from. So we know it's bad. I mean, the bearing's still good. It's not making noise, but it's leaking. It's time to go. Now that I pulled the water pump out, it was time for me to go upstairs and grab a brass bristle brush. I wanted to go and just kind of clean the scuzz off of it. So at that point, clean it off, and then you can take either degreaser, mass airflow cleaner, or a Pacifico if you have one, and just kind of wipe that crud off, and then you were just about ready to throw your water pump back on. Hey, buddy. Want a beer? Want a beer? No? You want a beer? Those guys might need a beer. What do you think? You can come out and inspect here in a little bit, okay? I will also mention, in between the barking pugs across the way over here, is that when I got the old water pump out, I transferred all of the bolts over from the new one I had in place to this one. That way I kept the order correct. And the first thing I was going to do is I'm going to take this stud right here, which goes right there, and hand tighten it in, hand thread it in, and so that way it's going to hold the water pump sort of in place for the other bolts to go in. Now everything is back together. I want to go over this belt routing just one more time for those of you playing at home. We're going to start up here just like I did in my radiator video, which actually I went and looked at just to make sure. We're going to start off at this idler over here. It's going to go over the water pump. It's going to go under this idler. It's going to wrap around the alternator. It's going to reach all the way over to your tensioner, which is right there. It's going to go wrap around the tensioner, and then it's going to wrap around the crank pulley, straight over to your AC compressor, and then it's going to jog back up here. So draw a diagram, or again, just kind of keep that in mind. Even though I just did this, I still had to look back. So don't be like me. Draw a diagram first before you tear everything apart. But all said and done, I think this is probably about 40 minutes. Now the next issue I've got to deal with is taking these little guys apart and recrimping them. Again, don't be a hack like me and make sure you actually know what you're grabbing onto when you try to pull this little connector apart. Anyway, thank you for watching. It's a nice day. Mr. Yogi Bear and I are going to go walk down to the Napa, which is about a quarter mile away. We're going to go get some orange coolant and go check out some classic cars later. What do you think, buddy? Hey, Yogi Bear here says, like and subscribe. Thanks for following. Buddy, you're being such a good boy. Well, luckily enough, we've got no check engine light from my questionable coolant plug repair down there. I'm waiting for the thermostat to pop open so we can bleed all the air out of the system, but so far, I am not seeing any leaks anywhere, which is good. That is all just remains left over from the stuff that dripped before. So it was all covered coolant down here anyway, so I'm not freaking out. Again, I don't see anything. Even the Wittig clamp or the spring clamp down there. Where is it? Let's get to it. The spring clamp down there, I don't see any wetness around that. Let's get this thing up to temperature. We'll find out what's going on. We have a very, very tired supervisor after our long, arduous, quarter mile walk down to Napa to grab some connectors. So this is what we got right now. Coolant is still sitting at 120, and yes, you want to talk about that little frustration right there. I had a spare tire sensor because my TPMS sensor wasn't even reading, so I went and grabbed a spare one I had from my Boxo Challenger parts, went down to my local Yanteria, threw it on there, and it's reading at zero. So it either needs to be recalibrated, or I just need to go to the dealership and spend outrageous money for a set of correct Continental ones like this car should have. But let's keep on looking here. We are still sitting at, let's go back to temperature, 123 degrees. I had a check engine light pop on for a second. I was kind of freaking out, but that's because I had the airflow meter, or the mass airflow disconnected, and I had the coolant temperature disconnected, so naturally it freaked out. But no check engine lights except for this annoying tire pressure sensor. So we're gonna get that fixed here soon. So hopefully by the time you guys see another tech video of mine here on YouTube, I won't have that annoying light. Hey friends, as I'm reviewing the video footage, I neglected to mention a few important details. First of all, there is that 15 millimeter stud that holds the water pump on. That's the one you see me talking about where I put it in first. The rest of the perimeter bolts on the water pump are 13 millimeter. Now, some of those bolts will actually bolt into the aluminum timing chain cover, and some of them will go straight down to the block. However, one thing I will mention is when you go to bolt it in like a crisscross applesauce pattern and Brave Star, do not use strength of bear on those bolts, because you can strip out the bolt holes on that timing chain cover and you're going to have a lot worse day than I did with that coolant temp sensor. Now, the bypass pipe itself, that little black pipe, is held in with that singular 10 millimeter bolt. That's why I mentioned the 10 millimeter. Unscrew that bolt, and then you're going to take a screwdriver and kind of wiggle that bypass pipe out. It's held in with one O-ring. It'll pop right out. You're good to go.
the coolant, you're going to need 2 gallons of that orange Xerox coolant. I would also say if you're in a hotter climate like Southern California or Arizona, throw some water wetter in there. You can go get that at any automotive supply store, and it will actually help your temperature drop considerably. It multiplies the evaporative cooling effects of your coolant, and it's wonderful stuff. Highly recommend it. Other than that, that should be pretty much about it. Your car should be running at about 199 degrees. Usually when you have your front bumper and all your under-tray plastics, you're going to be running about that. If you're an automotive degenerate like I am and you're missing your front bumper, it'll run about 208, 209 degrees. But if you have any other questions, drop them down here. I can ask you. I'm just kind of hoping that this will help somebody else out. I know I was trying to make a shorter, quicker video, but this is what you get. 15 minutes of shenanigans with Yogi and I. Stay tuned because we're going to be doing some more stuff. I got a lot more things planned for the Challenger. Now that it's getting up in mileage, and I want to keep this car on the road because it's a wonderful vehicle. So if I can't find it on YouTube, I'm going to do exactly this and make a video. Thank you for watching. Like and subscribe. Like I say, we've got more Challenger stuff to come.